Good morning, students. In the last class, we started with the first chapter, that is power sharing. Now today we'll continue with that. Now we studied about the problems that existed in Belgium and Sri Lanka. Today we'll discuss as how that problem was solved in both the countries, what process was there, and how they were different from each other. Okay? Now let's begin with Sri Lanka. So in Sri Lanka, the process that was adopted, the measure that was adopted was majoritarianism. Now let me explain what is majoritarianism, because you have that in the first measure. So it's a belief that the majority community should be able to rule a country in whichever way it wants, by disregarding the wishes and the needs of the minority. Now, if I tell you the concept of majority and minority, majority, of course, the one who is in greater number, more in number, and minority constitutes the one who are lesser in number, right? So what happened in Sri Lanka was Sinhala community was in majority, right? They were in majority. So Sinhala community secured dominance over the government, and that was due to their numerical strength. Okay, if we go back in the history, then Sri Lanka emerged independent in 1948, and the leaders of the Sinhala community, they secured dominance over the government due to their majority. And as a result, the democratically elected government, they adopted a series of majoritarian measures in order to establish Sinhala supremacy, Sinhala dominance. And since Sinhala supremacy was established, you see here that an act was passed in 1956 in order to recognize Sinhala as the only official language. Now, since Sinhala has been accepted as the own official language, naturally it disregards the Tamils, and Tamilians will be, you know, dissatisfied with this thing that Sinhala has been accepted. You have a Sinhala government, you have the Sinhala as the official language. Now, with all such measures, Tamilians felt alienated. Now, there were not just these two things. You have the governments following preferential policies as well, which favored Sinhala applicants for university positions, for government positions. So there was no place where Tamilians had a representation, let's say, for that. And even if they had, then that was after the Sinhala community. There was no equality, right? And therefore equality became an issue. Majoritarianism became a concept that was practiced over there, disregarding the minorities. Now, all these government measures that were coming one after the other increased the feeling of alienation among the Sri Lankan Tamils. And they felt that none of the major political parties that were led by the Sinhala leaders were sensitive to their language and to their culture, were neither considerate to their language or to their culture. And that is why they felt that the constitution of Sri Lanka and the government policies denied them that equal political rights, denied them the equal opportunities. Now, because of this, what happened? The relations between the Sinhala community and the Tamil community got strained over time. And the Sri Lankan Tamils, they launched parties and struggles for the recognition of Tamil as their official language, for having the regional autonomy and equality of opportunity. And gradually, since most of their demands were rejected, suppressed, their demands went on increasing. They started demanding for more autonomy into the provinces. And by 1980s, finally, several political organizations were formed demanding an independent Tamil state in the north and in the eastern parts of Sri Lanka. Finally, the distrust between the two communities turned into a civil war. Now your question should be, what is a civil war? Now, the wars were violent conflict between two opposing groups that takes place within a country. It becomes so intense that it appears like a war, basically. That is civil war. And here, which are those two communities? Sinhalas and the Tamilians. Now, that is why the civil war came as a setback for Sri Lanka. And as a result, thousands of people of both the communities were killed. Many families were forced to leave the country. And that was a terrible setback for the social, cultural, and economic life of a country. Because be it a civil war or any kind of violence, that always makes a country suffer. You do not gain anything, but you lose a lot of things. You lose it economically, you lose it socially, you lose it culturally, and that becomes a bane for the country. Right? Am I clear till here? Let's move on to the next country, and that is your Belgium. So what happened in Belgium was a different process, and I would call it a mature process, where you listen to the other communities as well. Now, when you do not listen to the other community, when you simply suppress them, then you will face violence. Because we all are humans, and if we have been living in a country as citizens, and we have been promised by the government of equality, and then when we do not get that, there will be questions. Now, when those questions won't be answered, there will be protests. Now, when those protests will be suppressed again, there will be retaliation. When those retaliation will also be suppressed by the government in either a violent way or in a non-violent way, the results also come similar. Be it a revolution, be it a civil war, or be it a negotiation. It depends on the process. It depends upon the means that the ends are decided. If you are peaceful enough, you get negotiations. If you are violent enough, you get revolutions, violence, wars. Correct? Now let's come to Belgium. Now in Belgium, what happened? The Belgian leaders, they took a different path compared to Sri Lanka. They recognized the existence of the regional differences and the cultural diversities. They addressed, they noticed. They did not suppress So between 1970 and 1993, they amended their constitution 4 times in order to bring out a solution which would enable everyone to live together within the same country. Isn't that a wonderful move? And the arrangement which they worked out was different from any other country and undoubtedly very innovative. We feel proud knowing about it, that in the land of humans, you have a country which has worked out in that way. And no doubt, India has also done that. So what were those innovations? Number one, you have the Constitution of Belgium prescribing that number of Dutch and French speaking ministers shall be equal in the central government. Equal. There is no majority and minority concept. Okay. Now you have some special laws require the government support, as in they require the support of majority of the members from each linguistic group. You have majority of the members who are to give their support. Not that majority is giving the one who is having more number of people in the country will represent in a better way, and the ones who have least will represent in the least way. No, it says special laws, some special laws require the support of majority of the members from each linguistic group, and therefore no single community can make decisions, you know, solely. Number two, many powers of the government has been given to the central, from the central government has been given to the state governments. And therefore state government is not subordinate to the central government. Brussels has a separate government in which both the communities have equal representation. French-speaking people accepted equal representation in Brussels because Dutch-speaking community has accepted equal representation in the central government. Isn't that a wonderful arrangement? Right? Now these two were the process, these two were the solutions that you see has been adopted in the countries of Sri Lanka and Belgium. What is it known as? You have majoritarianism in Sri Lanka, you have accommodation in Belgium. Now it's up to you to judge now. Which do you think is more equal, more considerable, more acceptable, more peaceful? Okay, so I leave you with this topic till here. About this third kind of government, that is a community government, I'll deal in the next class. Okay, all right, till then you'll do your assignments, you'll understand, go through your book, you'll understand the topic. If you have any problem, you'll let me know. Okay. Thank you, students.